Thank you very much for the invitation to this prestigious seminar. I should apologize for only being present virtually, so to speak. Unfortunately, long flights are a little risky for me. I would like to start by talking about C.F. Chitkin. This is a photograph of him, and this is his statue at a very prominent square in Copenhagen. Carl Friedrich Chitkin, he lived from 1829 to 1901. And he was probably Denmark's most enterprising businessman throughout the ages. He was born in Odense, the same town as Hans Christian Andersen. He joined the board of the private bank in 1857. And he transformed the bank into an investment bank for forming new companies. And in fact, he founded more than 10 great companies, including Great Northern Telegraph Company in 1869. And most of the companies are still in operation, some under different names, and some have been merged with other companies. This is a painting of Chitkin at the Copenhagen Stock Exchange in 1895. And the painting is by Coyer. And you can see that he's the central man at the Stock Exchange. Well, in 1869, Great Northern won the concession to install and operate the Trans-Siberian Telegraph Line in competition with three other consortia, two British ones and one Russian. And the idea was to extend the line from Vladivostok to China and Japan, and to do it faster than the British competition that went south of Asia. This is a picture where you can see the telegraph line from Copenhagen, Moscow, Vladivostok, Nagasaki, and all the way down to Hong Kong. And the British competition going from UK and south of Asia and also to Hong Kong. Why Denmark? Well, Chitkin's strategic political capabilities were excellent, and his financial credibility was good. And then he had the excellent Danish diplomat Julius Frederik Sick working for him. He was stationed in Russia at the time, and he were in close contact with important Russian officials. And furthermore, Denmark was a small country, so there was no threat of political interference. And Great Northern had already installed a submarine cable under the Baltic Sea to Russia. And this cable could easily be linked to the Trans-Siberian line. And finally, the Danish king, Christian IX, helped. His beautiful daughter, Dagmar, had become Grand Duchess, which means the future Tsarina, in Russia. This is a photograph of Tsarina Fyodorovna, that became her Russian name, at the coronation in 1883. And this is a photograph of the Tsar family from 1892. You see Fyodorovna and her husband, Tsar Alexander III, and their five children. Now, Great Northern sets up a subsidiary firm called Great Northern China and Japan Extension Company in January 1870. And Edward Suenson is appointed the director. And shares are sold at the London Stock Exchange. This is a photograph of Edward Sørensen. He lived from 1842 to 1921. He became lieutenant from Naval Academy in 1861, and he was headhunted later on by Titkin to install the cables Vladivostok, Nagasaki, Shanghai, Hong Kong, and he did a great job. So he was appointed director of Great Northern from 1874 to 1908. And he even became the chairman of the board from 1898 to 1916. And under his leadership, Great Northern Submarine Network grew from about 4,000 nautical miles to almost 8,400 nautical miles. Well, on March 3, 1870, Great Northern ordered 2,400 nautical miles of cable from Hooper's Telegraph Works in England, as far as the inner part of the cable is concerned. And that was after specifications by Great Northern. And the cable includes rubber as isolation material, which is the latest modern technology at the time. And Siemens Brothers, also in England, manufactured the outer part, including armoring with steel wires. You see the cable here, the steel wires, and the copper wires, and the insulation. Now, Hooper's Telegraph Works was formed in 1870 to undertake both manufacture and laying of submarine cables. And the first order was actually the one from Great Northern. And in 1871, Hooper's purchased a vessel and converted her to help laying the cables, renaming the ship Great Northern. This is a photograph of Great Northern. Well, on the Danish side, Great Northern borrowed from the Danish Navy the steam frigate Tordenskjold, and the king accepted that one of Tordenskjold's decks was cleared of cannons and arranged for transportation and laying of cables. And equipment and salaries were paid by the Navy, and operating costs by Great Northern. So this is a painting of Tordenskjold, and this is a photograph from the harbor in Copenhagen. A few words on Tordenskjold. Peter Wessel Tordenskjold, he was born 1690 in Trondheim, which was in Denmark-Norway at the time. He became a naval hero, and in 1719 he was appointed vice admiral at the age of only 29. Unfortunately, he was in 1720 he was killed in a duel in Germany. Well, the Hong Kong Shanghai cable was laid in the autumn 1870, but was defect, perhaps due to insufficient storage or handling. So it had to be recovered and later repaired in a bay near Hong Kong. That was kept secret in order not to harm the value and sale of shares at the London Stock Exchange. That would have been illegal today, but not at the time. So the cable was quickly repaired and reinstalled. The first Danish diplomatic mission to Japan was in 1871. And this was Julius Frederick Sick. I have already mentioned. The year before he was in Russia. He was received by the Japanese Emperor Meiji, and he negotiated with the Meiji government, and the government guaranteed access to Nagasaki and allowed Great Northern to operate the Vladivostok, Nagasaki, Shanghai, Hong Kong cable. On July 17, 1871, Great Northern begins installation of the Shanghai-Nagasaki cable. And already on August 12, the cable opens for traffic. So there was a notice in the Nagasaki Express. The company is prepared to forward telegrams from the station at this port to all parts of the world in telegraphic communication. On August 17, a third cable ship, Africa, begins laying of Nagasaki-Vladivostok cable. And on January 1st, 1872, the Trans-Siberian cable was also installed. So Vladivostok Station begins operation to Japan and Europe. And actually, the entire project was completed successfully. So the foundation was laid for Great Northern to become a great multinational company. This is an advertisement from the Great Northern London office on January 1st, 1872. And it reads that the Great Northern Telegraph Company now forward messages for Hong Kong, Shanghai and Nagasaki by way of Russia. And the rate was about £4 for messages of 20 words, which was probably very, very expensive at the time. So this is a picture of the Nagasaki station from outside, and this is the equipment inside the Nagasaki station. Now, as to the signaling speed in those days, I found some figures for the Ireland-Newfoundland cable from 1866, and there the speed was 6 to 8 words per minute. Not much compared to present-day technology. Well, there is a fairy tale called The Great Sea Serpent by Hans Christian Andersen from 1872. And according to Andersen, when submarine cables were laid, all the creatures in the sea thought they were great sea serpents. Maybe like this. So extract from that fairy tale. Good for nothing, said all the creatures in the sea, and held fast to the sea cow's opinion, so as to have an opinion. The little fish had its own thoughts. That exceedingly long, thin serpent is perhaps the most wonderful fish in the ocean. The very most wonderful, say we human folks. It grows in might and in length, grows year by year through all seas round the world. Well, Hans Christian Andersen was right, especially because of modern photonics. You see a modern submarine cable. It looks a little bit like the old telegraph cables, except the copper wires has been replaced by the optical fibers, and now the capacity is incredibly high. Thank you very much for your attention.